Good afternoon to everyone. I'm very pleased to introduce the speaker of today. Professor Clement Boehm is a full professor in computer sciences at the University of Karlsruhe in Germany. Before that, he was a professor at Magdeburg University near Berlin. And before that, he was affiliated with ATH in Zurich, and before that with GMD. So he does a lot of research in advanced computing infrastructures, such as peer-to-peer and grid systems, and also on data management. He's visiting Purdue for 2 months and doing research on how to build and develop trust management techniques.
Okay. Thank you very much. Welcome to my presentation. I'm actually very excited about it because it's my first appearance on television. I've just found that out a short time ago. So I might even be a bit nervous. In Germany, we don't have this distinction between local and national television. So I'll just tell my folks back home that I was on television and they will be very impressed. So today's topic is trust models and behavior-based trust models, to be more specific. And here's my introductory examples. So in Karlsruhe, we work together with particle physicists. And these guys spend a lot of time writing code that does something that is useful from the physics perspective of things, like analyzing data, pre-processing data, doing computations, whatever. And once they have written this code, they let others use this code. Well, we have to be more specific. It's others can use the code, but it's not that you can like download the code. You must run the code at their site for various reasons. So it's like a service-oriented architecture, if you wish. The other issue that is important is that, of course, they are willing to share their code and their resources with others, but not to an unlimited extent. So in particular, they want to differentiate between others that have been cooperative in the past, that have let them use their resources as well, compared to, let's say, research groups that have been unreliable, that have been uncooperative, etc. in the past. So there's, as I said, they want to let others use their services, but not to an unlimited extent. Now you might say, why don't they just auction off their resources and those that pay the most get the resources? Well, there are 2 reasons that are in the way of this. The first one is cultural. So in the scientific community, you can't really take money for letting others use your developments. It's not common, be it in computer science, be it in physics. And the other more severe reason is that when it comes to auctioning off resources, that is, when it comes to buying and selling things, then it's like a contract that has to be set up. And then having a contract requires that lots of specification needs to be done to come to terms regarding the various conditions of the exchange. And then this would result in a lot of work that needs to be done to specify things, etc. And physicists really do not want to do this. They want to share their resources with others that are cooperative, but otherwise not be bothered with the gory details of specifying contracts, etc. So this is not exactly a solution that is applicable here. So the next issue that comes to mind is that different individuals have a different perception of who is trustworthy or not. That is highly subjective. So I might be willing to share my resources with certain individuals that someone else would not share the resources with. So it's very subjective. So this calls for, a mechanism or a language that allows the physicists to specify a, let's call it, trust policy. And this trust policy expresses then who is allowed to use which service under which circumstance. And our objective is exactly the design of such a language and the efficient evaluation of statements in this language. More specifically, we are interested in behavior-based trust policies. Behavior-based means the following. It's the opposite is structural in the sense that I trust you because you're a professor or I trust you because you're from Purdue. That's structural. That's not behavior-based. Behavior-based means we look at past interactions and based on that, the decision whether someone is trustworthy or not is derived. So, and that's particularly useful in settings that are anonymous, like the internet, where ensuring that somebody has a certain identity would require a lot of work, etc. On the other hand, there's a drawback to behavior-based trust policies. It's that you must have information on the past behavior of the various individuals available. And typically, if you systematically collect information on the past behavior of the various individuals, a large volume of data typically is collected in short time, and the problem becomes, well, kind of a data management problem. I'll be more specific in what follows. So our interest, to make it short, is in behavior-based trust policies or in the design of and evaluation of behavior-based trust policy languages. So here are some examples of behavior-based trust policies. I hope you can read it from the back. So if you look at it, it's written in a very colloquial style, and of course our concern is to formalize this at the end of the day. If you look at it, it looks simple at first sight, but then if you look at it in more detail, there are some intricacies here. For instance, we have this, Carol says, blah, 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 I only interact with someone if the K most reputable entities recommend him. So there's this notion of reputable that is involved in this policy, and this needs to be formalized as well. Then we have what we see as further is that there's a number of notions like feedback, recommendation, reputation, etc., that kind of needs to be clarified, and we need to come to terms what this means. Further, the other thing is that we can distinguish based on the context. For instance, Dave makes a distinction regarding the complexity of the tasks, and of course, other facets according to which a distinction can be done are conceivable. So, in the introductory example that I have given, it seems that only the service providers have to make a trust decision. So trust means I trust someone. When I trust someone, then this someone can use my service. But it's not only the service provider that does this. It's also typically the service consumer that takes this decision. In particular, if finding the service provider and interacting with him takes a lot of energy. So it's not only the service provider, but also the service consumer that kind of wants to have this this framework that we are talking about here. So now looking back at the examples, there's more comments that can be made about them. The first one is that obviously the trust policy issue, it requires, at least if you take the past behavior into account, it requires computations and operations that are typical in data management. For instance, aggregation. So we have had, in one example, we had this notion of average feedback. So this means that the average needs to be computed in the first place. And then, okay, we have these different notions that have already been mentioned, like feedback, reputation, recommendation, and finally trust. And the requirement is that these notions need to be sorted out, and we need to become more specific what exactly they mean. Now, another issue that kind of will be picked up later in my presentation is the following one. If we look at things, that is, we have these participants and we have these relationships between them, then all this can be depicted as a graph. So the node of the graph are the various participants, and then we have edges between them if there's like, let's say, a feedback relationship or a recommendation relationship, whatever you want, between these two individuals. So this can be depicted as a graph, and once we have done this, various graph-specific measures that allow to quantify the importance of nodes, for instance, are applicable, and a lot of research has gone on in this direction. So there's a number of measures that allow to quantify the importance of nodes based on the structure. These measures go under the name centrality measures, and I'm still in the introduction of my talk. They will play a role in the formulation of the trust policies as well. So what are the research issues that, from our perspective, need to be addressed? Well, our concern is trust policies. The first thing is a language that allows to specify trust policies is needed, needs to be specified. Then the statements in the language need to be evaluated efficiently. This is not trivial. We have seen that the trust policies typically involve complex computations. And finally, the issue that is most intriguing from our current perspective is the effectiveness issue in economic terms. So which policies or which combination of policies really ensures that interactions, when they should take place, do indeed take place. I'll come to that towards the end of my presentation. And okay, we have not fully covered this research agenda. So in this talk, I'm going to present our current results. What do we have by now is we have looked at the literature on behavior-based trust issues, and we have tried to identify the issues that are important in order to come up with the language thought. So this is basically the first item here. we do have a language. It's not beautiful yet. I'll come to the specifics here. It's an algebra instead of a real language. But this algebra allows us to formulate all the notions that we have in mind, and I will demonstrate this. And finally, we have implemented all of this, what I've been talking about so far, and we have done various experiments regarding the effectiveness and the efficiency of different policies. So this basically concludes my introduction. Here's my agenda for the rest of the talk. So I've finished the introduction. The next item on my list is terminology, so I'll introduce some... I will become more specific regarding the different notions that are around. I have to talk more about centrality and how that affects the policy language envisioned. Then the next step is I'll talk about our algebra that allows to formulate the trust policies envisioned. First of all, what's the idea? Then there are some obvious extensions, well, not obvious, there are some extensions that others have taken care of already. And then finally, how does centrality come into the fray? Some experiments, if time allows, I'll be more detailed. If not, I'll go over these. And then finally, this is very, I love this topic, how to investigate the effectiveness of different policies. So, as mentioned, there's a number of notions that the introductory examples already have revealed. And now let's talk about these different notions that are around and that are important and what exactly they mean in our context. So the first notion that plays a role here, if you remember the introductory example, is the one of feedback. So the idea is as follows. If there's an interaction between two participants, then after the interaction, the two participants rate or they assess this specific interaction that they had. That is, they generate feedback on this interaction and give this feedback to some, let's say, central authority, central node that stores all this that stores all the incoming feedback. So feedback basically is, if you wish, is the basic building block for what comes next. Feedback typically refers to a specific interaction that has gone on in the past. So I should say we don't make any assumption about the truthfulness of feedback. That is, if you issue feedback, you can lie. We don't care. You can even go further. You can even invent feedback on interactions that have not taken place. You can even invent feedback on interactions that have not taken place. So it's just... feedback is the basic notion that is under the other concepts. So the next notion, recommendation, is kind of what you would expect. So I can issue a recommendation on someone. That means I say that, well, I tell at least the others that this someone offers a service that others can use. So again, we do not say how to arrive at a recommendation. It's up to the individual participant if he issues recommendations, and it's up to the individual participant how he arrives at his recommendations. So he can even be completely untruthful. And the idea is that using our language, each participant can specify how and under which circumstances recommendations about other participants are generated. Now, if you look at it, feedback and recommendation, they are always between two participants, one that issues the feedback or the recommendation, and the other one is the one the feedback or the recommendation is about. Now, our next notion is reputation. That's a bit different from these first two notions, because that's like a global characteristic of one particular individual. So reputation, if you wish, is the standing of a particular individual in the community. And again, we do not say how the reputation of someone needs to be computed. It's again, policies need to be specified according to the taste of the individual participants. And these policies then say which individual has a high reputation, which one has a low reputation, and so on. And then if you specify the reputation policy, you can refer to feedback, you can refer to recommendations, whatever you want. And also, if you specify recommendations, you can refer to reputation, you can refer to feedback. It's completely up to you. And now the final notion, that's the important one, is the notion of trust. So trust is what you want to have from others, because trust, if someone trusts you, then it basically means that this other individual lets you use his services and so on. So that's desirable. And compared to trust, all the other notions like reputation, recommendation, etc. are auxiliary. And then again, we do not say when someone else should trust someone. All we do is we provide a language that allows someone to specify under which circumstances he trusts someone else. So these are the important notions that we kind of have distilled from looking at the literature. We haven't found such a classification in the literature. That's why I kind of introduced this here in a rather prominent way. Then if we look at the literature, there's a number of behavior-based trust models that have been proposed, and there's various notions that are part of these trust models. So for instance, the different issues like recommendations, feedback, etc., they can come with a value. So if you're not, you can, for instance, if you want to say, well, it's been fairly good but not top, then instead of having either value 0 or 1, the range can be continuous. Then what's typically done is that there's a differentiation between the context. So if you look at my example, there's differentiation between computations of type X, whereas on the other hand, we have computations of type Y. This is what we call context. The next notion is the one of there's different facets. For instance, I can do computations of type Y very efficiently, but on the other hand, with poor quality. So that would be a distinction takes into account that there are different facets of a specific context. Then it has been observed that the feedback, etc., should be time-stamped to facilitate giving more emphasis to more recent feedback. So that's the notion of timestamp. Then certainty, if you're not completely sure about the feedback or the recommendation that you're giving, you can add a certainty value to this feedback, recommendation, etc. And then also if you want to quantify, that's another notion that the literature has proposed, if you want to quantify the extent or the effort that the service provider had to go through, then you can also add like an effort value to your feedback, whatever. So let me summarize what I've said so far, just to kind of get you back into the boat. I have motivated the problem that we need trust policies in distributed environments, and that other solutions that one might have in mind at first sight are not exactly practical. The other thing that I want to kind of mention again in my short summary at this point is that we have introduced this distinction between feedback, recommendation, reputation, and trust. This is rather important. I haven't found it elsewhere in literature, but it's important for what follows, so that's why I mention it once again. Okay, now I've covered the first two items in my agenda, introduction and terminology. Let's look at centrality in more detail. So here's again an illustration that is similar to what we have seen before. On the top right, you see a table that contains feedback that individuals have issued regarding each other. And then, okay, there's a value associated with each feedback object. There could also be the other aspects, but for the time being, we just limit it to the value. And then down here, you see this obvious transformation from the table style representation to a graph-like representation. So the individuals are the nodes, and the tuples then end up being edges in this graph. And now the interesting thing, if we do this transformation based on the feedback information, is that the graph that results, it has certain properties. So for instance, it's a directed graph, of course, because someone issues feedback on someone else and not in the other direction. Then it's not strongly connected. If someone has never interacted with someone else, it's likely that there are no edges going to this node or coming in from this node. Then the next thing is there's typically multiple edges between two nodes. In particular, if you look at feedback and these individuals have interacted repeatedly, there should be several edges between these nodes. And typically, these edges have a weight. So this, I mentioned this because I'll come back to it in a couple of slides. And now, given such a graph, we can now apply certain centrality measures in order to quantify the importance of the nodes in the graph. So this centrality measure is a notion that has been broadly investigated in the recent past, and it's accepted that it helps to quantify the importance of nodes, so that's undisputed. Now, what's less clear is which centrality measure should be applied. There's a number of measures that has been proposed in the literature, and typically together with these proposals, scenarios have been described where the particular centrality measure that is being proposed performs favorably compared to the competing measures. So it's not clear which measure to apply. And if you look at it, the measures typically yield different results. So here's an example. There's a very small graph on the left, and three different centrality measures have been applied to this graph. You see the result in the top table. So you see, for instance, if you do the in-degree centrality measure, then node D has the highest score, whereas if we do the page rank, then node E has the highest score, and node D only comes in second, if you wish. And now, at the bottom, typically, we do not care about the absolute values. We are more interested in the order of the nodes, and then the representation of the results at the bottom represents this. So you have to read the table as column-wise. So each column is like a ranked list of individuals. The one that's on top performs best regarding this centrality measure, and then they become a bit worse. Okay. Now there has been a classification of the different centrality measures recently in the literature, and the classification is between local measures, eigenvector-based measures, and distance-based measures. Local measures are the simplest ones; they're easy to compute. They only take the direct neighborhood of nodes into account. Now, eigenvector-based measures are more complicated. They are typically based on recursion. So, for instance, I could say a node is important if it has many incoming links from other important nodes. That's basically the PageRank definition, if you wish. And then there are other eigenvector-based measures that are a bit more complicated, like a positional weakness and so on. And now, distance-based measures, they are even more complex. They say that a node is important if there are many other important nodes with short paths leading to this node. So you take the distance from other important nodes to the node in question into account. Okay. Now the interesting thing is that in order to apply the different centrality measures, the graphs where these measures will be applied have different characteristics. So if you look at the first kind of measure, the local, it is applicable to all kinds of graphs. They can have multiple edges, single edges. They can have weighted edges, unweighted edges. Local is always applicable. With eigenvector-based, it's a bit more complicated. They are not applicable if there's multiple edges between nodes. They're only applicable if there are single edges or if the graph is unweighted. And with distance-based, it's actually worse. The graph has to be unweighted, and there may not be multiple edges between nodes. This is important because it means if we have the feedback graph, and like let's say we have a distance-based centrality measure that is the measure of our choice, then we first have to transform the graph into a unweighted one with single edges in order to deploy the measure. And this, on the other hand, means that we will have a loss of information before doing this transformation, typically before we can deploy our centrality measure. So, and then to make things worse, for instance, if you want to do the transformation from multiple edges to single edges, different transformation schemes have been proposed. So, for instance, there's this Eigentrust transformation. It's fairly simple. Since time doesn't really allow it, I don't want to go into the details. I just want to mention we have different ways of transforming transforming graphs with multiple edges into graphs with single edges. One scheme is the Eigentrust transformation. There's a more flexible scheme that's called the beta transformation. It is better. I don't want to explain why. If you want to, I can point you to papers. And it's better, but on the other hand, it is parameterized. So there's a parameter that you must choose carefully. And if you don't choose the parameter carefully, then using the beta transformation doesn't really make much sense. And now, similarly, if you want to go from graphs with weighted edges to graphs with unweighted edges, there's different transformation schemes are conceivable. Here is on this slide, you see one. It's very simple. You just drop all edges whose weight falls under a certain threshold value. The point is that, again, we need to parameterize this transformation scheme. If we have this parameter as threshold value, then the resulting graph looks different from this graph that is the result of the transformation with this threshold value. So why am I telling you this? Well, because it's important for the policy language that we have in mind. The first thing is that obviously the policy language that we have in mind should be able to take into account any centrality measure. So apparently, the question which centrality measure do I choose is a question of taste, and a language that is flexible should allow for any centrality measure. Further, since research in this field of centrality measures is still ongoing and new measures are being proposed all the time, and supposedly they are better than existing ones, our language should also be extensible. It should allow for adding new centrality measures that are not known at this current point of time. And further, since the data need to be transformed, and this transformation can be there are alternatives how this transformation can be done. The way this transformation looks like should also be part of the language envisioned. So that's why I have mentioned it. Okay, so let me summarize this. So centrality is an important notion that the language envisioned must take into account. However, this is more complex than it seems at first sight because different centrality measures are around, and then different centrality measures require different kinds of pre-processing of the underlying data, and all this should be part of the policy language envisioned. Okay, now does anybody have any question at this point? I'm ready to, if you want, we can. Do we have one? No? Okay. So I guess I just go on then. So now let's talk a bit about our language. Of course, we have looked at the literature, and the trust policies has been an issue that has received some attention so far. Well, I would say more attention has gone to structural trust policies as compared to behavior-based trust policies. The problem with the trust-based policies is that they are like logic-based, and then it's difficult to take the computations that I have just talked about into account. Like we have aggregation, we have applying centrality measures, we have the transformation of the underlying structure. All this is slightly difficult if we have a pure logic-based policy. So on the other hand, since databases and query algebras etc. have been around for a long time, relying on this bag of concepts seems to be very promising. So what we have done is that we have transformed. Our idea is that the information on past behavior should be transformed into relational structure, and then the language that is used to formulate trust policies should be something that is similar, or in the best case even identical, to, like, let's say, the relational algebra. This has two advantages. The first one is that if we rely on this, we can leverage all the concepts and all the technology that has been proposed in the field of relational databases over the past decades. So this is basically the second item here. And then the other advantage, but this is something that only turns out to be an advantage a posteriori, is that if we take this approach, we can actually show that we are able to express all the different kinds of policies that have been proposed in literature and that are conceivable with this framework. So here's an illustration of what I have just said. The idea is to have the feedback data as an underlying relation, and then the other concepts like recommendation, reputation, and trust are basically views on this underlying data. And the specification of this view is left to the various individuals, and on the other hand, they are then supposed to use our language. So for instance, if we have Alice issuing feedback on Bob, like here, regarding service S, etc., then a new tuple that goes into this relation here, this is the schema of the relation, a new tuple that is inserted into this relation is the one that we see down here, okay? And now, what needs to be done, of course, we need to look at the relational algebra and ask ourselves, is the relational algebra sufficient to come up with, to express the different, trust, recommendation, and reputation policies that are conceivable? And if this is not the case, which kind of extensions are necessary? Well, this I can basically skip because I've mentioned it. So let me give you an example. Here's, before I go into these extensions, here's an illustration of one particular trust. Here's one illustration, this is a trust policy in natural language. And down here, we have the equivalent to this trust policy in our extended relational algebra. So if you look at it, I don't want to explain the details. If you're interested, I can point you to a paper which we have published. If you look at it, it looks pretty much like a relational algebra expression. So you see there's join, selection, etc. But there's also some new operators that are not part of the standard relational algebra. And what I'm going to do next is I'm going to tell you which kinds of extensions are necessary in order to model all the different trust policies that we want to have. And these extensions basically fall into two groups. The first one is there are extensions to the relational algebra that others have been proposed and that are useful in our context. This is what is here conventional extensions. And then, as insinuated before, we need some extensions that allow us to take centrality into account. And this is, if you wish, a new extension. And I'm going to talk about this after having covered the conventional extensions. So the first kind of extension that is needed is we need to be able to truncate the set of feedback items or the set of recommendations. So for instance, the top operator has been proposed to do this. And then we need something like the map operator, which takes as input a tuple and generates for each tuple a new attribute according to some function that is the parameter of the map operator. Let me show you two examples. Here is an illustration of the top operator. So this is the input to the top operator, and then top operator is parameterized. It says how many tuples shall survive, and according to which attribute. So it means that the top three tuples by value are supposed to form the result, and everything else is supposed to be dropped. And you see the result here. So that already exists. Others have proposed it. And now the map operator. You see it here. This is the input relation, and the map operator tells us what the function is that is supposed to be applied. It's value times effort. That's the function that's supposed to be applied. The new attribute that contains the result of this computation is called weighted, and here you see the result. So here's the new attribute, and the values that we have here are the products of value and effort. So it's basically, it's also a part of conventional extension of the relational algebra where functions are brought into the picture. Okay, now let's talk about centrality. That's a bit more difficult. The problem when we want to deploy the centrality operator is that the graph structure is not obvious, or to be more specific, the centrality operator must allow us to specify what exactly the graph structure is, where the centrality computation is supposed to take place on top. So, for instance, if we look at this, this is my example relation here, where my example is based on. If you want to say that, let me go on to the next example. This shows it better. Here's my relation where I want to compute the centrality on. And now, for instance, let's assume that I want to take as edges these individual tuples, and then the edges are from the recommender attribute to the recommendee attribute. Then this results in these two parameters that are part of my centrality operator. And further, the next parameter is then the centrality measure that I want to apply. So I've mentioned that any centrality measure shall be applicable, and this is handled by having the centrality measure as a parameter to the centrality operator. And then the other important attribute is the first one here. It's the new attribute that as a value contains the result of the centrality computation. So for instance, if we apply this operator to this relation here, the result that we get is the one below, is the one that we have down here. And these are the PageRank values computed based on the graph where the edges go from the recommender to the recommendee attribute values. So the centrality operator is sufficiently open so that it allows to specify what exactly the graph structure is, the centrality computation takes place on which the centrality computation takes place. Okay, so let me briefly summarize. What have I explained so far? Our idea has been to basically look at the relational algebra and take that in order to formulate the trust policies envisioned. However, the relational algebra as it stands, it is not sufficient. We must have certain extensions to it. There are some, extensions that have already been proposed, like the map operator and the top operator. But then there's another extension that is new. I haven't seen it before in the literature. It's the centrality operator that allows us to, well, bring it, to have centrality as a first class primitive, centrality computation as a first class primitive within our database. And it's important in order to formulate the various trust policies envisioned. Okay, and now what needs to be done, we haven't done it, is the, like, let's say, the usual database research program. If you extend the relational algebra, then certain things are what should be done, like what are algebraic equivalences that involve the centrality operator, then how does query optimization change if we have centrality as a notion that is part of, well, first of all, how does the query language look like if we have centrality as a notion that is part of the, that is part of the database? How does query optimization change if we take this into account? Then statistics management, selectivity estimation, all this is the classical research agenda that is also applicable, that should also be investigated here when dealing with such an extension of the relational algebra. So we have not done this yet. One reason why we haven't done it is because we have started to become very interested in the effectiveness issue. I'll come to that in a minute. So any questions at this point that I might be able to answer? Okay. So let's talk a bit about experiments. I'm going to be brief. I'm not going to present all transparencies that I have. I should say that, first of all, experiments have been a lot of work. One reason is that it has been difficult to set up, to generate the test data and set up a framework where this data can be tested. So the idea basically is that we have built a what is called feedback generator, and there we have simulated interactions between participants. Participants have been furnished with a what we have called cooperation value. So if your cooperation value is 1, then you always cooperate. If your cooperation value is 0.3, then you only cooperate in 30% of the cases. And we have let this population of agents, if you wish, play against each other and then taken the feedback that they have generated on themselves and used that as input in order to assess the various centrality measures and the different trust policies that are conceivable. Now, let me look at some results. This one is interesting. So let's focus on the x-axis and the y-axis and the z-axis. The x-axis indicates the number of feedback items that have been generated during the lifetime of the system. So we start over here with 0. Initially, no interactions have taken place and no feedback has been generated. And then this grows over time. So at the end, there are 250,000 feedback items. Then that's with... I don't remember the number of peers. Well, anyhow, we had 50, that means 50 feedback items per peer. So that's already quite a high number. That means you must have interacted at least 50 times with someone else. So that 50 feedback items per peer are available. And now the z-axis, FWD means fraction of wrong decisions. So if you look at it, we start out quite high. In some cases, we start out with a fraction of wrong decisions of 50%. And then, of course, as feedback becomes more, this rate gets lower. But still, it requires like 50 feedback items per peer in order to arrive at a fraction of wrong decisions that is acceptable. So that's a bit disappointing. So we were hoping that the centrality measures were kind of better in sorting out cooperative and uncooperative participants, but however, this requires a lot of feedback in order to do this. And since a system typically is dynamic, we are not sure if this what will happen if the system state changes shortly over time. Okay, this I'll skip. It's very specific. I'll also skip this. Let's look at this for a second. What this transparency shows is a comparison of the different centrality measures. So the interesting thing is, this axis is not so important. The interesting thing is the y-axis. It's again the fraction of wrong decisions. And now the different colors, the curves in the different colors represent the quality of the different centrality measures. And what we can see that is that in the simple setting, which we have investigated here, all centrality measures are fairly close by. So that's interesting, because on the other hand, you don't see it in any graph that I'm showing you, I'm just telling you this, on the other hand, computing the various centrality measures may be very time-consuming. In particular, with distance-based centrality measures, this typically takes hours, whereas eigenvector-based centrality measures, their computation is relatively fast compared to this. So our conclusion from this is that distance-based centrality measures should only be applied under, well, let's say, exceptional circumstances, because in larger networks, they are not, they cannot really be applied because their computation simply takes too long. Okay, so let's summarize this. The experiments kind of confirm what has been pointed out before. There's no clear winner regarding the centrality measures. So this calls for a policy that lets all the various participants specify how exactly they want trust, reputation, etc. be computed. Well, both when looking at, when comparing the different centrality measures, we must take both effectiveness and efficiency into account. And then, okay, we need quite a number of feedback items in order to arrive at a fraction of wrong decisions that is acceptable. I have mentioned this. Okay, now let's come to the last item in my presentation. That's the effectiveness issue. So what the problem that comes to mind is, if we have different populations with different trust policies, and then these populations and then these individuals from the different populations interact with each other, how successful will they be? And that's it's a very interesting and a very important question from an economic point of view. So far, I don't know if this has ever been addressed. All that has been addressed is the assessment of individual trust policies or of individual models in isolation, but the combination of this, and in particular how humans react to this and which kind of trust policies humans would really choose, is an issue that has not been investigated as far as I know. So how do we investigate it? Well, we have designed a game, it's called the service game, and playing the game is a lot of fun. Well, actually designing it and working with it is less fun, it's a lot of work, but it's very interesting. So the game works like this. Let me briefly explain this. We tell the participants that each participant gets to control one computer. And this, what they have to do is, they have to tell the computer how have to specify a trust policy for their computer. And now the game is round-wise, that is, in each round, the computer belonging to one participant gets to issue one service request. And this service request is then randomly assigned to another computer controlled by another participant. And then the trust policy of that other participant comes into the fray, and the computer decides, the node of the other participant decides if it will execute the service request or not. Okay? And then, of course, the game is that the objective of the game, from the player perspective, is that you must accumulate as much credit as you can get. And, well, processing a service for someone else incurs costs. So if you're short-sighted, you shouldn't process service requests from others. On the other hand, if you do this a couple of times, then your reputation, then your others will notice this, and they will not process your service requests in turn. So you should be careful. And that's exactly the point here, when to process a service request or not. And then on the other hand, issuing a service request is free. And then, of course, having a service processed yields a benefit. And the benefit is, of course, larger than the processing costs on the other side. So this is how participants actually can increase their balance. And then at the end, what we did, we actually gave, in some circumstances, we gave money to the players, depending on how much point they have obtained during the game. So we are not very far evaluating the results, but we have set up the platform. I can show you a screenshot. It's in German, so because we are playing this, it's not for Americans at this point. Sorry. So we're playing with Germans. What you do is you basically write down your policy here. You write it down in natural language for the time being, and we translate it to our algebra. So that's why I'm looking for contact to people who have experience in specifying languages for, well, trust, access rights, whatever, in order to have this more automated in a later stage. For the time being, we basically we expect the participants to write their policy here in natural language, then we translate it into the algebra. Down here, you see your policy. Well, this means, this is my policy actually, when I've played this the first time. I trust everybody except those that have not executed a service request of mine. That has been my policy all the time. I've done fairly well playing against my colleagues with this policy. and then there's another screen that you get to see as a player. So this dotted line is the maximum number of points that you can achieve. That's the ideal situation if all your requests get processed. And in blue, you see how well you have done within the game. And now there are some subtle design differences. For instance, we could show you not only how well you have done, we could also show you how well the others have done, how well you have done compared to the average. And this has, as far as we have observed, has very important consequences regarding the behavior of the participants. So for instance, if you're worse than average, then typically you start to become to change your policy kind of hectically and try to do something better. So this that's the interesting point here. How do the subtle design issues influence the behavior of the participants and what kind of policies result? So I can give you some hints what has happened so far. Well, players have not yet used centrality measures in their policies, even though we played it with computer scientists. But take this with a grain of salt, because maybe once you play this game longer and policies become more sophisticated, they might actually resort to it. So it's not the end of the day yet. And then I've mentioned, if you don't give the players information on the standing of the other players, the game is going kind of smooth, compared to when you let them know how well they are doing in comparison to other players. Because then things get kind of hectic, and it's more like, it's not about performing well, but it's more about performing better than the others. So that's a very important issue that needs to be taken into account when designing these games. Everything's a bit difficult, because typically the situation is not really deterministic. If you have the same players with the same policy, then they may have very different results in the course of the game. It depends on, there are some random effects that take place during startup, which kind of influence heavily the outcome or the progress of the game. And we are about to investigate this. Okay, so let me briefly summarize. So the fundamental research questions that I have addressed, or that we are interested in, is how do we establish trust in distributed systems? How do humans interact in such settings? Like, whom do they trust? Under which circumstances do they find someone else trustworthy, etc.? And then on the more computer science oriented side of things, how should a language that allows to specify a trust policy look like? So we have an algebra, I've mentioned that, but that's not, it doesn't make us completely happy, because an algebra always contains information how the execution should look like. We want to have a really declarative language that is then automatically mapped to some algebra expression. And hopefully I might find some help with this here in Purdue. And then efficient evaluation of statements in this language is an issue that's also very difficult, but it's very important to us. And we haven't done much work on this, and maybe I can get some advice on how we should approach this here in Purdue as well. So, okay, we have done lots of things. I have mentioned it. Let me skip this transparency and go to this one. That's my last transparency. So what needs to be done in the future next to the things that I have mentioned? I have not mentioned the last two items, and they are fairly important. The first one is distribution. So far what we do is we collect all the feedback that is available in one central node. You might not like this, because this node has a lot of information on you, on all your interactions in the past, and that's actually not good. So we are thinking about how could the data be distributed, let's say in a peer-to-peer system or somewhere else where no node has a distinguished role. And at the same time, all these computations that we envision here can take place without too much extensive effort, let's put it like this. And then finally, another issue that's very important is privacy. I mean, we just collect the data on all interactions. That's absolutely not in line with German privacy legislation. I don't think it's okay from a US perspective as well. And so this needs to be investigated. And another issue then is, if I'm kind of restrictive regarding privacy. For instance, I only allow that certain feedback on myself is published and other feedback is not published. Does this have any impact on my economic success in such a system? So can we arrive at general statements that or general insights regarding the relationship between the two, that is privacy on the one hand and economic success on the other hand? So this concludes my presentation. I was supposed to talk 50 minutes. I have 15 seconds. I have
so. Maybe one question.
Yeah. So you can be on TV if you ask a question.
I have a question.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So actually, I have two, but
two.
Let me start. One question that I don't know if you mentioned this, but where do you actually keep track of the history of the peers? Like, if your policies are history based, we assume.
We collect all the feedback in one central database.
That is like shared and known to...
Yeah, that's what I meant with the last point. We should have distribution.
Oh, okay.
So it's, for the time being, it's all in one database. I know it's not good, but there are so many complex problems involved here that this is where we started.
Okay.
Maybe we can...
You have a second question? Go ahead, ask it.
No.
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay, so thanks very much.
Okay.